Laura Bragg, the daughter of a minister from Massachusetts, was a groundbreaking woman who was a lifelong learner, innovator, educator, and one of the key figures in the formation of the Poetry Society. As a woman born in the second half of the 19th century, her exceptional achievements were against the odds. Moreover, she was almost completely deaf by the age of six, making her accomplishments in later life especially awe-inspiring. In 1909, she was offered the job of librarian of the Charleston Museum at the paltry salary of $600 per year, which is roughly the equivalent of $16,000 in 2021 currency. She was sold on the job by the museum's director when he convinced her that with the dreadful economic, racial, and intellectual state of affairs in Charleston, she would be doing the equivalent of missionary work. She had never visited Charleston before taking the job and was shocked at its disheveled appearance when she stepped off the train. Eventually, she was named the director of the museum, making her the first female director of a municipal museum in the United States. But as her responsibilities expanded, her pay did not. Bragg lived at the edge of poverty. She was often in a position of borrowing money from her father and asking for advances on her pay to buy food or other essentials. She was a renter for her first 2 years in Charleston, but soon thereafter began a pattern of living with close female friends and arrangements known as Boston marriages. These were, at least on the surface, financial arrangements between unmarried female friends who pooled their resources to maintain stable homes without a male breadwinner in the household, such as a husband or bachelor brother. It is also true that these were often lesbian relationships, and Bragg's biographer makes a fairly airtight case that this was true for Bragg and her roommates over the years. For the purposes of the history of the Poetry Society of South Carolina, Bragg's most significant life partner was Isabel Bowen Hayward, who was known familiarly as Belle. She owned this house at 7 Gibbs Street, where they lived together for almost 12 years. She was older than Bragg and a Charleston native with important family lineage, going back to Judge Thomas Hayward Jr., making her a distant cousin of DeBose Hayward. Belle was Bragg's frequent caregiver during periodic bouts of extreme nervous exhaustion and other illnesses. She was also trained, as women of good families of the time were, to be a gracious hostess. Those two features of their partnership came together during the influenza pandemic of 1918 and 1919. Bragg caught the flu, survived it in an utterly weakened state, and required a year to fully recover under Hayward's care. It was during that recovery, when Bragg had idle time to read, that she became interested in poetry. She purchased a subscription to Poetry, a magazine of verse, and nurtured a friendship through letters with its owner and editor, Harriet Monroe. As was her practice with any new fascination, Bragg delved into poetry with intensity and focus to learn as much as she possibly could. Her interests were on poets writing at the present time in modern forms, and not of poets and styles from the golden antebellum past. This made her unusual in Charleston. Bragg was a natural educator. When she learned something new, she strove to teach it to others. She began mentoring Josephine Pinckney. They had known each other through the museum when Pinckney was a high school student at Ashley Hall, an all-girls private school. Bragg also worked on poetry separately with Helen von Kollnitz-Heyer, an employee at the museum with a natural talent in poetry. Elizabeth Miles and Elizabeth Myers, aged 28 and 18 respectively, were also taken into the group. Eventually, the four women met together under Bragg's guidance and Belle Hayward's hospitality here at 7 Gibbs Street once a week. After Belle's suicide in this house in the fall of 1926, Bragg purchased and renovated 38 Chalmers Street, where she lived for the rest of her long life. When she died in 1978, she was 96 years old.